Thank you so much. Thanks, guys. Thank you, and good morning. Happy first day of summer to everybody. I'm proud to announce today that we are, as a state, we're announcing our new superintendent of state police, as well as a historic investment in our public safety capabilities. I'm honored to be joined by our newly confirmed secretaries of public safety and correctional services, and also juvenile services, Carolyn Shruggs and Vinny Schiraldi, and also with our lieutenant governor and our deputy chief of staff for public safety, Bud Frank. And before and as we begin, I want to start with a little bit of context of where we are in the crime fight in Maryland, how we arrived at this point, and where we plan on going from here. First, it is undeniable that our public safety agencies have a critical and urgent and important work to do in order to keep our communities safe, but it's also clear that they are stretched remarkably thin. In recent years, recruitment and retention across law enforcement and the public safety profession have fallen to modern lows, and we continue to ask too few to do too much. During the transition, I had the opportunity to tour some of our law enforcement facilities and capabilities and was struck by the size of the State Police Academy class. In previous years, we might have seen a class size as reaching as high as 80 or 90 recruits, and today the average class size is 35. The class size that I saw when I visited was 19. This starts with new trooper applications, which have dropped from 4,000 per class in 2019, and is now fewer than 1,000 in 2022. That leads to smaller academy class sizes and fewer academy graduates. We're also seeing attrition outpacing hires. Last year, 80 troopers left employment and only 47 joined the workforce. Like the rest of state government, law enforcement and public safety have struggled to rebuild its ranks. Thin staffing limits, what our state police and our public safety agencies can do to keep us safe, is straining the entire state. So ultimately, to rebuild the state police force, we must elevate the profession, invest in training and development of our troopers, and do all that we can to cultivate a culture that retains, advances, and rewards the most effective and ethical law enforcement professionals. The Maryland State Police is the vanguard of law enforcement in our state, and at its best, this is exactly what the state police has done. And under our administration, this is the standard that we will ask the state police to uphold. Second, my administration recognizes that violent crime impacts all 24 jurisdictions in the state of Maryland. Over the last 8 years, homicides and non-fatal shootings have increased to unacceptably high levels all across the state. And the data is clear. This is not an urban problem. This is not a rural problem. It's not a Baltimore problem alone. This is a Maryland problem. I'd like to take a few minutes to walk through a few slides which illustrate exactly what I'm talking about here. On this first slide here, homicides and fatal shootings have increased over the last decade statewide. Non-fatal shootings have doubled, and homicides increased by about 50%. These are statewide numbers, and we're watching how the trend lines show themselves. For the second slide, when you disaggregate the data, because we want to break down and show exactly how this data is showing itself, when you disaggregate the data, homicides have increased in Baltimore and across the state. And while Baltimore continues to take up the majority of homicides, the majority of the homicide share, it's important to know that the state's rate of increases outpaces Baltimore. And so what we're watching here is how the state movement is actually continuing at a higher pace. For the next slide, when you disaggregate the data, fatal shootings have increased in Baltimore and across the state, with a greater share of shootings occurring across the state relative to a decade ago. This slide here shows a similar dynamic to what we saw in the second slide, where you have a trend that the trend to the homicide slide, that if not for world-class and well-trained medical professionals, many of these numbers would be homicides. Gun violence is straining our healthcare system that is already overburdened. I can tell you, just a few weeks ago, I had a chance when we were up over at the University of Maryland Medical Center over at Shock Trauma, and we were meeting with Dr. Thomas Scalia, who was the doctor who was saving the life of two of our officers who were shot when they were shot by somebody who got access to and shot two of our officers with an AR-15. And when I got a chance to talk to Dr. Scalia and asked how he was doing, his answer to me was simple. He's tired. And he's tired of having to conduct the same type of operations for the same type of challenges. This is not just a Baltimore problem. This is a statewide problem. Violent crime and its drivers span every jurisdiction in the state of Maryland, and it's fueled a palpable sense across our state that people simply do not feel safe. The core drivers of crime, most notably an influx of illegal guns, have played a huge role in perpetuating the cycle of violence in our communities. And to address the violence and advance public safety in all of our communities, the state must engage as a partner in the crime fight across the state of Maryland. Today, and therefore, I am defining the mission of our state police as leading the coordination and providing cross-jurisdictional resources, intelligence, and guidance to all of government as we work together to advance public safety across the entire state. The state of Maryland must lead. My administration will lead. As a state, we will do so through partnership with all of our 24 jurisdictions by investing in intelligence sharing and also effective investigations and, when necessary, directly intervening to disrupt and stop crime. We will work with our state agencies, our local partners, to source data on where we are today and to track our progress going forward. And to that end, I am ordering all public safety agencies across the state to include all state police agencies, corrections, and juvenile services to conduct after-action reports when there are homicides or non-fatal shootings within their areas of responsibility. I learned this as a young officer in the Army. You would do AARs for everything. You'd learn from every incident, every failure, every mission. That is the only way to improve and to bring forward the lessons that are going to prevent the next tragedy. I have said time and time again, our administration will be data-driven and heart-led. And nowhere is that more important or more needed than the realm of public safety. We are going to follow the data, and we're going to disrupt crime wherever it happens. And as Marylanders, our hearts tell us that we must. Third, I'm proud to announce a historic investment in the state's elite public safety capabilities through an $11 million investment in the Maryland Coordination and Analysis Center, best known as MCAC. The MCAC includes staff of 30 federal, state, and local law enforcement agency partners to source intelligence from across the state of Maryland, neighboring states, and our federal government to improve and also improve our ability to monitor and disrupt violent crime. The MCAC gathers and analyzes tips and leads on suspicious criminal activity and known criminals, and also provides accurate, up-to-date information to further empower local law enforcement officials to close more cases and to drive more complete and effective investigations. In order for our state to get this right, we have got to increase the closure rate that we have within our state. We've got to make sure that we have the capacity and the capability to have intelligence sharing, so when these things happen, our ability to close these cases becomes real. For example, MCAC's unique and powerful tools can help us to better understand where illegal guns are flowing into our state identify who is bringing them here and from where, and give us the necessary insight to disrupt and stop criminal activity. The MCAC is a unique and vital resource for our state that has brought extraordinary capability to the crime fight. And they've also largely survived on grant funding. We can and we will do more. We can and we will do better. As my administration brings a serious, a sober, and a sustained focus to reversing the violent crime trends over the last 8 years, we must sharpen our capabilities. And this investment will enable MCAC to stabilize and grow its highly trained and expert personnel, conduct trainings to strengthen the capacity of public service, of public safety agencies to fight crime across the state, while also investing in technology infrastructure to keep us safe from cyber attacks and threats from the homeland. So in short, an empowered, fully funded MCAC will help to ensure that the state of Maryland is a critical, value-added partner to all of our local jurisdictions as they fight crime. Our job is not to look at the local jurisdictions and tell them to do better. Our job is to make sure that we're being a real partner in this work. I'm also pleased to share that MCAC and the city of Baltimore have resumed an active partnership. Bringing our state's elite intelligence and investigations capability to our state's largest city and a community that has been devastated by crippling crime. The fact that we had an MCAC operating and Baltimore City was not a part of it makes absolutely no sense. That's changed. This funding for the MCAC complements our other substantial public safety investments in our fiscal year 24 budget, including a $122 million investment to aid local police departments, which, by the way, includes $17.5 million dedicated to Baltimore City, nearly $69 million in direct local law enforcement grants, including $5 million to protect Marylanders against hate crimes, $35 million for the Victims of Crime Act funding to provide victims with the assistance and the service necessary to aid their restoration after a violent criminal act. Rebuilding our law enforcement and public safety agencies by attracting and retaining the very best. Leading with data, transparency, and accountability. Investing deeply in partnership and effective collaboration. These are our immediate priorities as we re-engage the state of Maryland in the crime fight. Going forward, we will follow the evidence and deploy best practice in the crime fight. We will address and repair a broken juvenile justice system. We will strengthen our correctional system and implement a parole and probation strategy that actually makes us safer and reduces recidivism. Through partnership and intentional investment, we will go after and successfully prosecute the most violent offenders and get them off of our streets. And we also want to emphasize this too, that we cannot and we will not police or militarize our communities out of this problem. Every Marylander must feel safe in their own skin. Every Marylander must feel safe in their own community. Our law enforcement and public safety strategy is not complete, nor will it be effective, without robust and vibrant community participation, including programs that involve the communities that are most impacted by the violence. Indeed, our Leave No One Behind agenda is a crime-fighting agenda. We know that when people have economic support and access to opportunities, crime goes down. We know the inverse is true, too. In the days and the weeks ahead, I will share more about our agenda to leave no one behind, but today we are focused on critical policing, intelligence sharing, and enforcement strategies to reduce crime, and also proudly announcing the leader who will help guide Maryland State Police into the future. As governor, it is my responsibility to define the mission and our priorities and to select the leader best positioned to drive the work forward. And I'm incredibly proud to introduce our next superintendent of police, Lieutenant Colonel Roland Butler. Lieutenant Colonel Butler brings nearly 30 years of experience in state policing. In 2020, Roland was appointed the chief of field operations bureau, leading a patrol force of over 1,000 troopers and investigative personnel assigned to 23 barracks across the state. During his career, Lieutenant Colonel Butler has served in line and supervisory positions in both the patrol and investigation bureaus, and he was promoted through the ranks, rising to become the sixth African-American Lieutenant Colonel in the 102-year history of the department, and proud to say he will now, upon appointment, be appointed as the first African-American in our state's history to hold this position. He also served on the superintendent's staff in the Office of Equity and Inclusion within the Maryland State Police Support Services Bureau and in other positions throughout the Field Operations Bureau. Lieutenant Colonel Butler combines this experience with the core values necessary to do this job well. Courage, fortitude, resilience, understanding, and compassion. In short, Roland's a professional, and he has the background, the knowledge, and the character to lead the Maryland State Police as it carries out this critical mission. It is my honor to bring Lieutenant Colonel Butler to the podium to share a few remarks, and then we'll take a few questions. Congratulations.
Thank you, sir. Good morning. Thank you, Governor Moore. Lieutenant Governor Miller, it's truly an honor to step forward and be able to take the reins of the Maryland State Police and lead the women and men of the Maryland State Police on a mission that the governor has clearly outlined that will improve the quality of life of citizens across the state. This will not be easy, but the women and the men of the Maryland State Police are prepared for this and are fully capable of making an impact and improving the quality of life of citizens across the state and those that travel through our state. I look forward to working with my many partners, cabinet members, as well as other law enforcement agencies across the state and our federal partners. And I'd like to thank you again for coming today, and thank you for the honor, sir.
Thanks, Senator. Well, time taking questions.
You mentioned about the nothing done investment. Could you summarize what that would look like so that people will know how it will benefit them in their community?
Absolutely. So for example, this is going to go towards how we have increased technologies and also intelligence sharing mechanisms that can help MCAC to better be able to get the intelligence, get the information, get the data, and then better provide it and share it with our local jurisdictions. So for example, you look at the part of that investment goes things like license plate readers, where that becomes one of the core ways for us to understand how these guns, for example, illegal guns, are being brought into the state of Maryland. They're being brought by individuals who are transporting them via cars. So an increased investment in things like license plate readers that the MCAC can then have, be able to process the information, and be able to have that as data sharing information is a core way that you're going to see immediate impacts on what that's going to look like in the everyday lives of Marylanders. Yeah, I'd say one of the first things that we did during the transition process was actually go by MCAC, and there were two big takeaways that I took. One, the remarkable debt of gratitude that we owe to these men and women who are doing this important work and doing the measurements of collaboration, and how woefully resourced they were to actually do this work. This is where you also have everything from school safety exists within MCAC, about how we're coordinating with local jurisdictions about intelligence sharing. And for example, we saw how with the city of Baltimore, they were not included in MCAC. You were literally having the processes of information of individual incidents that were taking place, and the city of Baltimore was not there. And we saw the same thing even when you look at what happened with Baltimore with the Criminal Justice Coordinating Committee, where the state wasn't involved. That immediately, once I had that first visit, that's when we said, we need to make sure that we are getting these men and women the resources that they need in order to do their job, and we're going to put together a new mission and a new focus about how are we going to prioritize coordination between MCAC and these local jurisdictions. And so it was across the board, we saw that you had this tremendous resource that was being underutilized and underinvested in and underappreciated, and in our administration, we wanted to center that inside this work.
State Police amount is making the agency. We've reported on a quota system for ticket writing. There's a federal civil rights investigation, and we're hiring. There were allegations of racist challenge coins being circulated. How do you plan to take this agency forward and change what appears to be a very problematic culture?
Thank you for the question. I intend to meet all these issues head on. Meet every one of these issues head on, good, bad, or indifferent. We can become better, but we need to find out what's at the heart of the matter. Quota systems are unacceptable. However, holding people accountable for what they're charged to do, that's perfectly acceptable. I will not support quotas. I will not support inappropriate behavior. We're here to safeguard the communities and the people within Maryland. We will do our very best. I will hold people accountable. My executive staff will hold me accountable.
Thank you. Yes. There were a few criteria that I knew I wanted to go into, and it was not necessarily saying I want to make sure that we're moving or promoting within. I said I want the person who is the best, and the person who I felt that who both understood the challenges that existed within the organization, but also had the core vision and the fortitude to be able to help lead us through it. And when you look at the experience in the history of Lieutenant Colonel Butler, this is someone who rose through the ranks, understands the system, understands the culture, understands the challenges that need to be fixed, but I think also throughout his career has demonstrated his ability to be able to push for and get better results from organizations and platforms that he has been responsible for. And so so after doing an exhaustive search of individuals who I knew I could trust to lead us through this time, it was obvious that both because of his experience and also because of his vision looking forward, that I knew that Lieutenant Colonel Butler was the person I wanted to go with.
Last question. Governor, yesterday, you talk about leave no one behind, and yesterday we heard that from some Republicans who are pushing this plan that they're calling a right to learn bill, is that if you want to leave no one behind, allowing parents to take their kids out of struggling schools is one way to do it. They also floated the idea that teachers unions were behind this idea of defunding the blue school.
I respond by saying the decisions that I make are my decisions, and no one is behind those decisions. That when we look at what happened within the platform for what we're trying to do, we are focusing on making sure that we're having 21st century public schools for all of our students. That is going to be our priority. That is going to be our focus, and making sure that that our public dollars and taxpayer dollars are going to be focused on that. While we understand the virtue, and if you look at the students who are in the Boost program, for all students who are in the Boost program, our policy is that those students can stay. Those students will be able to complete. A promise was made to them, and that promise will be honored. But we also know that as we're thinking about that what needs to happen with public dollars, that public dollars should not be going to private schools. Public dollars are going towards ensuring that we're building a world-class public school system for all Maryland students.
But those schools right now where those students aren't world-class schools. So how does the plan work for the students who are facing those struggles right now?
Yeah, our philosophy and how we're going to address this is not going to be a measurement of defeat. We've got to make sure that we're working in partnership with the local jurisdictions and working with in working with the local educators, the local school boards, to ensure that the state is doing its part to make sure that they have the resources and the supports and the guidance they need to provide a world-class education for all of our students, and working with all of the local jurisdictions, Baltimore and beyond, to make sure that that's what they're providing for the students.
That was the last question. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.